Anda sedang menonton dan mendengar rancangan Berita Busters, satu rancangan mengenai berita dan hal ehwal semasa yang berkaitan dengan COVID-19 di Malaysia, di rantau Asia Tenggara dan juga di seluruh dunia. Saya adalah Zan Azli.
And I'm Shell Ibustawan.
So minggu ini adalah episod di mana kami bercerita tentang isu media sosial dan sebaran berita palsu. And my favourite is the name of the episode that I have come up with. WhatsApp.
WhatsApp dengan kamu.
Apa tu?
Oh, ya ke?
Ya.
Cool. Sure.
Okay, so kita mulakan dengan berita yang terkini yang pada kami telah menambat perhatian kami. Okay, dan berita ini adalah beberapa hari yang lepas Menteri Kanan kita Ismail Sabri telah menyatakan bahawa di Malaysia selama 2 minggu dah tak ada lagi orang yang disabitkan kesalahan menyebarkan berita palsu yang berkaitan dengan COVID-19.
Tanya
rakyat Malaysia. 2 minggu. Yay.
Bagus. Tapi ni berita berkaitan dengan COVID-19 sahaja.
Ini adalah berita palsu yang berkaitan dengan COVID-19.
Berita palsu yang lain
kita tak tahulah mana. Berita palsu lain siapa Perdana Menteri semua tak tahulah. Kan? Tapi ya, maknanya Malaysia boleh dikatakan berjaya bendung sebaran berita palsu mengenai COVID-19. Betul atau tidak?
I mean, this is really good news, obviously, showing that Malaysians are kind of being responsible. But we also have to think about the fact that we had to enforce a law in order to get people to stop spreading fake news. And now that we have enforced this law in the time of COVID-19, does it then curb into the freedom of us later on?
Bebas kebebasan media, kebebasan bersuara dan sebagainya, betul? Kan?
Ha. Dan apa definisi berita palsu sebenarnya? You boleh disabitkan salah for anything really, yeah, as long as it falls under a very vague
definition yang sebenarnya news. Kalau kita lihat apa yang Jabatan Penerangan Malaysia telah keluarkan, bahawa apa yang diberi definisi sebagai berita palsu adalah apa-apa berita yang mungkin mengkritik pemimpin-pemimpin negara.
Dan lain-lain lagi lah.
Banyak lagi lah.
Guidelines dia semua sangat tidak jelas.
Boleh tengok episod sebelum ni. Yeah. Kita ada buat satu episod tentang isu ini sebelum ini.
So okay? Tak jelas, and then basically undang-undang ni boleh digunakan untuk almost apa-apa saja.
Ya, yeah, betul.
Berita yang tidak disenangi pihak-pihak yang berkuasa.
Untuk episod ini, kita ada baris wartawan-wartawan tersohor seperti biasa. Dan kita akan berbincang mengenai isu ini.
Hari ini kita bersama dengan seperti biasa wartawan-wartawan tersohor kita. Dan minggu ini kita bersama Lintan daripada Arab News, Daniel Anthony daripada Kini TV dan juga Hadi Azmi daripada Benar News.
Yay.
Apa khabar semua?
Okay, so hari ini?
Hari ini episod kita seperti yang telah kita umumkan tadi dalam segmen pertama, yes, adalah WhatsApp with you. Yo, WhatsApp.
Laugh, okay.
Are you guys like very amused by my puns that I come up with,
yes,
for the title?
Yes, absolutely. Or, no, absolutely. It's not. Okay, so cerita pertama kita adalah.
Very much. Yes.
Cerita pertama kita adalah media sosial. Kita dapat tahu sekarang kalau kita tengok di media sosial banyak berita palsu yang disebarkan dan diedarkan di media sosial. Dan bila kita sebut media sosial ni, antara media sosial yang paling popular untuk berita-berita disebarkan tak kira palsu atau tak palsu, even though it inclines towards the palsu, adalah WhatsApp. WhatsApp adalah satu media sosial yang sangat popular. Dan juga ada Facebook, ada Twitter, ada Instagram dan sebagainya. Kalau kita tengok, pada awal-awal MCO ataupun PKP di Malaysia, ini bulan 3 hari itu, bila PKP ini mula when it was implemented kan, kita tengok WhatsApp sebagai satu syarikat telah mengeluarkan kenyataan yang mengatakan bahawa mereka akan cuba membendung gejala atau masalah sebaran media sosial. Dan mereka kata, okay, mungkin tak bolehlah nak terus bendung, terus stop. Mereka ada encryption system dan sebagainya. Diorang tak boleh tengok pun message-message kita. So, diorang tak tahu yang mana palsu dan mana tidak. Tapi mereka akan tambahkan lagi filter ataupun proses untuk bagi orang susah sikit nak share.
So, Hadi, tell us, how is this WhatsApp measure of not forwarding it working out for you?
Actually, for myself, I've witnessed this feature where they limit you from forwarding messages to only like a few people at a time instead of like spreading it straight to a group, which is a bit detrimental to how I work, because reporters, we often need to share information with like several people at once. So it's tedious in that way, but then I can understand why WhatsApp is implementing it. Actually, I think, if I'm not mistaken, they first started implementing it a while back when for cases happening somewhere in South Asia. So it was, I think from what they learned from there, they decided to implement it worldwide for COVID-19.
But has it really been effective though? Because personally, I'm still receiving a lot of fake news. So like Daniel, has it been working out?
I don't think so, because the whole nature of fake news is it's not so much how to control it, but news in itself is how we stay informed about everything in the world. Fake news in itself is an abuse of the system of news. So, you know, in my eyes, it's a case of, you know, don't hate the player, hate the game, because we need to tangani the kind of people who are abusing the system. If you put this measure in place, diorang punya matlamat is to break the system. So diorang kind of figure out ways to beat the system, regardless of all these kind of things you put in place to, you know, beat it.
Yeah, I guess for people who are spreading fake news, maliciously, knowingly spreading fake news, I think that would, for them, it would be like, they will always find another way to do it. But I guess for the people who are unknowingly sharing fake news, I think it is a filter that can help prevent them from unknowingly becoming like spreaders of information, of fake information, I suppose.
Betul. Sebab itu Facebook, mereka telah berkata secara umum in public, dia orang kata dia orang ada masalah untuk membendung masalah orang-orang share fake news ni, detect misinformation, sebab it's news, like apa yang Daniel kata tadi, it's an abuse of the system. Dia orang dah ada sistem untuk bagi orang kongsi maklumat, tapi dia orang ada masalah sebab macam mana kita nak tahu apa yang tak betul, apa yang betul, dan mereka menggunakan artificial intelligence ataupun algorithm untuk determine kan benda macam ni. Twitter ada bagi solution dia orang adalah sebelum pengguna nak share, sebelum dia pengguna nak kongsikan, akan keluar sign. Dia akan tanya, have you read the article? Dah baca artikel ni ke belum sebelum you share? Aline, apa pendapat kamu?
It's good to tell, you know, the sharer yang diorang dah baca ke tak. Because, I mean, admitted that most of us sometimes or most of the time do not really read past the headlines. But I do want to focus on the specific demographic that are at a higher risk of spreading and accepting and forwarding fake news. And these are the older generation. But interestingly, majority of the research in Western countries found out that most of the people who share fake news are the older generation. Asian Network for Public Opinion Research annual conference in 2018, they reported that both the young and the old, regardless of their education background and regardless of their age, both fall victim to sharing fake news, which is interesting. They found out that 30% of their respondents did share fake news. And to me, this could be an Indonesian trend, but it could also be a Southeast Asian trend.
Betul. Now, apa yang Ali kata tadi, sebenarnya boleh membawa kita kepada story kedua kita, iaitu sebenarnya kalau kita tengok di mata dunia, di rantau Asia Tenggara, mereka kata negara-negara di Asia Tenggara adalah negara-negara yang sebenarnya paling berjaya membendung masalah berita palsu mengenai COVID-19. Diorang bagi contoh negara seperti Vietnam dan Cambodia, mereka ada undang-undang yang ketat kan, bila ia berkaitan dengan berita palsu. Mereka kena saman, boleh masuk mahkamah dan juga mungkin dipenjarakan.
Which is not very different from what Malaysia has as well since the COVID-19 pandemic. However, there is also criticism that says that all these anti-fake news laws, all this clampdown on fake news is also a way to curb free speech. So Daniel, what's your thoughts about that?
Well, the anti-fake news law has been controversial since it started out, but I also want to come back to what I said just now about how people who spread fake news, dia memang are going to find a way around this. So there is something that has happened recently. You know, kita orang, the whole nation's focus on the news now is bertempah siapa akan jadi PM, right? You know?
Siapa
so
yang
a fake
PM,
news
betul?
Thing that's been going around is how do you create fake news about this? So people, you know, the so-called fake news beginners, they can spread macam, oh, they decide that, then this one's going to be PM, that's going to be PM. But there's a trend now, and it's on the internet, people call it necrobumping. It is digging up an old story from like 5-6 years ago and sharing it sebarkan and clicking on it sampai dia akan jadi trending and also sharing it out. So what something actually recently happened with, among my family members is that regarding the PMship, they dug up the story that oh, Pakatan Harapan setuju Dr. Mahathir akan jadi calon PM. And they're sharing it and the people are saying, dah jadi, dah decide, calon PM. You check the date on it, it's 2018.
Do your family members listen to this show, watch this show, and then they're like, Daniel!
Share the link with them.
It's not fake news. It's benar.
It's benar. Tapi dah basi lah.
And then you uncheck the news site is a real news site. It's not like those. There are some of people Photoshop, screenshot then Photoshop tukar headlines semua ada lah. Tapi this is real. It's an actual article. And you know how news sites publish the date really small.
Ha, macam Aileen kata sebenarnya semua ini adalah negara-negara yang mempunyai kerajaan authoritarian. Tapi Aileen, saya nak tanya kamu, sebenarnya negara-negara authoritarian ni seperti Vietnam, mereka berjaya membendung masalah COVID-19. Their infection rate is very low. Di Malaysia, kita dah hampir dah semalam berapa orang? 6 orang.
5 or 6.
Ah, sebab kita pun masa awal-awal MCO, masa awal PKP, ramai orang masuk mahkamah sebab berita palsu COVID-19. Kan? So mungkin ini adalah the trade-off we need to do. Screw democracy, tapi yes, kita tak mati sebab COVID-19.
Well, this sounds like a lot of the argument of people or political scientists that are pro authoritarian regime. They say it gets the job done. So screw our freedom. Well, I think we need to have, you know, perspective in the impact of such fear tactics. It may work in the short. You get the kind of people that you want to do the things that you want. But it doesn't really solve the real issue, which is fake news. You have to remember that the tendency, if you really want to share something, you will find a way to share something. That's the reality of human nature. It doesn't really address the long run of how do we identify fake news as, you know, human society, you know? Why everything has to be centralized, has to be focused on what the government can do for us. We should look at alternative measures at addressing the issue of fake news. Even though in the short run, using fear tactics may address the global pandemic problem, but in the long run, we have to remember that COVID-19 may be with us for a very, very long time. Maybe not just this year, maybe in a couple of years until it's, you know, there's a vaccine or whatever.
Maknanya, kalau kita pergi ke story ketiga kita, apa yang Aileen dan Hadi dan Daniel cakap, kita tak tahu. Sebenarnya, dia apa yang kita, story ketiga ni adalah apa yang Malaysia, inisiatif Malaysia buat. Kan, untuk membendung berita palsu tentang COVID-19.
Which Hadi is such a big fan of.
So diorang telah, diorang menggunakan website sebenarnya .my.
Yeah.
Dan mereka ada Telegram group juga untuk rakyat Malaysia yang nak tahu berita benar. Dan kalau tak silap saya, every day, setiap hari, kerajaan, kementerian komunikasi akan keluarkan senarai berita-berita palsu untuk hari ini. Yeah. Adakah inisiatif ni sebenarnya berjaya atau tidak?
Yeah.
I'm still not sold by this whole sebenarnya thing lah. It's there. It is actively trying to tell us what is the correct one, what is not the correct one. But it is not, I think it's not marketed well enough for people to know. I think most of the public still don't know what sebenarnya is.
I tengok website sebenarnya.my. I think it's like a short story website to go and read fictional story about Sang Kancil dan Pak Pandi and all that. I don't know why that is the perception again.
Yeah. Dia tak ada that feel of like authority.
So there's a Telegram channel for the MKN messages, and there's also a Telegram channel for sebenarnya.my.
Yes.
So in that kind of situation, Daniel, there's always a wealth of information out there, but the government is trying to streamline the information by telling you to join like the MKN Telegram channel. But then the government initiative sebenarnya.my also has a Telegram channel. How do you then think the public will consolidate the information that they read? Like, do I now have to join both the Telegram channels? And like, if I join both the channels, what if I compare the news side by side? Will it be current? Will it be different? So as a member of the public, how what is your advice to them to like, how do they sort of consolidate that? Should they just go and read Malaysia Kini instead?
Those people who take initiative to compare, maybe, yeah, it would be very confusing for them. And but I think for the greater public out there who kind of, as Arlene said, baca headline je, then believe dah. So I think one message is enough to convince them. They're not going to dig deep into the situation unless they have a legit interest in the story. So, you know, my family, pasal sometimes if it's talking about, you know, some topic that they're quite invested into, they will go into it and start asking me, or then I can see diorang Skype call or WhatsApp call with somebody, and they bincang-bincang for half an hour and trying to figure out which one is right, which one is wrong. You know, while sites like sebenarnya.my, which, you know, hint at the Kementerian Kebenaran that I was mentioning earlier, is, you know, they give this information, tapi it also creates this ground for people who have more questions. Tapi tak boleh tanya, because if I'm not mistaken, the Telegram group is a broadcast group.
There was an instance, I think, near the time when they opened up, was it phase 2 or phase 3, just before Raya, when they opened up interstate travel. I think it was between like the 7th to the 10th of May or something like that. And there was an MKN message that came in right after that, on the 11th or the 12th, that said, now you are no longer allowed to interstate travel, even if it's for work or for deaths. And a lot of messages in my like family, for example, came in and they're like, what? So we're not allowed to like even travel back? Then how am I going to go to work? Because that was the time when industries were also opening up again. But the actual fact of it was the message, what the message really meant was that if you've already traveled from point A to point B, you're no longer allowed to go from point B to point A or point B to point C. So you're only allowed this one time travel and that's it. So then in cases like that, Arlene, you know, how do you think people should react, or how do you think people should go and look for their news sources? Because it's a lot of work. Like you said, it's the older generation that are more adverse to this kind of thing and falling for fake news, right? And people are generally not very rajin lah. They're not going to go look for, you know, side-by-side comparisons or whatever. So how should people try to find like the most, I guess, accurate news source possible?
Which is why we have people sharing news on social media, is that that drive wanting news, the drive to want to get as much stories as possible to understand, you know, what is happening around them. To be honest, there's no real news, because the system of sourcing stories in Malaysia is, I would say, it's a bit broken, partly because this is the lack of freedom of expression, and we, I mean, imagine someone living somewhere in Sabah and they wanting to get, you know, they want to get stories about, you know, their own community or things that is happening within Malaysia. What if they have more questions? Hence why you have people sharing videos their own opinion pieces, and then we share it to re-forward it to other people. Partly it's because they know that there's something out there that needed, you know, to be uncovered, but they just do not know, like, you know, where to get the sources. Hence, the spreading of fake news.
It is. They also need to be a clear separation between what is fake news and what is unconfirmed news, because we have seen on WhatsApp, like, someone recorded a video nampak KKM punya officer pakai PPE pergi angkut orang pada speed mic, bawa stretcher, lepas tu macam, and then when the press ourselves ask KKM about this, or they say like, oh, fake news. How can it be fake news? Who goes around in PPE form and, you know, and pick up random people painting, kan? Have somebody saying something about it. Don't just simply dismiss it. You know, because like early during the early days of MCO, there were like a lot of people who were on ground saying that, hey, KKM actually came to my shop and then pick up like my colleague who was, I don't know what happened to him. But then KKM say, oh, fake news. I'm like, okay. Like, what's going on?
On that note, sebenarnya, I think we had quite a fruitful discussion, yes. Perbincangan yang sangat bernas, dan saya ingin sekali lagi mengucapkan terima kasih kepada Alin Tan, kepada Hadi Azmi dan kepada Daniel Anthony. Terima kasih sangat kerana meluangkan masa dengan kami.
Sebenarnya. Okay, terima kasih Hadi Azmi, Arlene Tan dan Daniel Anthony.
Terima kasih meluangkan masa bersama kami.
So, sekarang kita masuk segmen kegemaran saya. Benar atau palsu?
I want to take a vote from all you viewers, penonton-penonton dan pendengar di sana. Siapa yang lebih berbakat mencipta tajuk-tajuk yang funny dan witty dan kelakar untuk rancangan berita bahasa sini? What's up with you? Hey, that was me, man.
I wasn't trying to be funny though.
Okay, anyway, sekarang segmen ketiga, segmen terakhir kita. Ha. Dan ini adalah segmen di mana, seperti Cheryl kata tadi, kita berbicara tentang berita yang benar ataupun palsu. Dan tip kami pada hari ini, yang kami ingin berikan kepada penonton dan pendengar semua adalah, kalau kamu lihat tadi segmen kedua, kita banyak bercerita tentang platform-platform media sosial seperti WhatsApp dan sebagainya. Mereka adalah platform di mana orang ramai senang untuk sebarkan berita palsu.
Yes.
So, kita pun ada cerita tentang inisiatif-inisiatif platform-platform ini untuk cuba membendung masalah berita palsu ini.
Yes.
Kan? Dan,
so,
yes.
So, the this week's tip comes from the company WhatsApp itself.
WhatsApp itself, yeah,
yes,
betul.
Yes, and it's on their FAQs.
Mereka memberi anda tip-tip supaya tidak terkecimpung ataupun terbabit lah dalam nak sebarkan berita palsu, yeah, dalam platform WhatsApp sendiri.
Hmm. Yeah. So, some of the tips that they bring up are tips like understand when a message is forwarded. So, dekat WhatsApp tu kan, kalau message tu disebarkan, ada line dekat atas yang cakap forwarded,
forwarded,
and ada dua arrow ke sana.
Ah, yes.
Yeah. So, kalau you dah nampak that message tu adalah forwarded, and ada dua arrow ke sana tu,
be
you can
wary.
Check your sources and check the videos. Yang kedua dia cakap check photos and media carefully. Sebab ditulis di sini yang foto dan video boleh diedit untuk dijadikan palsu. So the third one is
cari message-message yang nampak pelik sikit atau aneh atau berbeza daripada yang biasa. Itu yeah, mungkin straight, dia red flag lah. So sepatutnya kita
and in that what lah. Does it say? It says check for things that have
ejaan yang salah.
Yes.
Seperti tip yang kita telah beri dalam episod sebelum ini.
I rasa WhatsApp ni tengok berita busters
lah. I think WhatsApp watches berita busters. Ah,
because
tengok berita busters yang menggunakan tip-tip kami. Tip
look
yang keempat adalah
check your biases. Yang kita pun pernah cakap.
Ya, yeah, betul. Apa yang telah dikongsi yang dikongsi banyak kali, most probably adalah berita palsu juga. Sebab berita palsu ni senang disebarkan.
So, berita-berita yang biasanya viral, yang adik saya dah tengok ni. Oh, kakak saya pun ada cerita pasal ni. Oh, nenek saya dekat kampung pun ada cerita.
Besar kemungkinan berita palsu.
Berita palsu. And the last one is verify with other sources.
Itu pun kita pernah bagi tip tu juga.
So, it basically goes back to checking your news sites, checking your other sources. Your grandmother in the kampung is not a credible source. I mean, I'm sure she's credible for other things like how to make rendang and stuff like that.
Hey!
But please,
domesticating women!
No!
Oh my god!
Or, you know, building a fence or a chicken coop or a tree house.
Macam mana nak halau biawak mungkin dia tahulah.
How to cook the biawak also. But for news, to check, to verify news, it's always best to go back to news sources.
Yep.
That's what I'm trying to say here.
So,
while checking with your family members, even if your family members are journalists and so on, it's not like they have all the time in the world to sit there and fact check all your news lah. Okay.
Yep. So, kalau anda ingin baca lebih lanjut dan ada video juga, pergi ke faq.whatsapp.com.
Or you can even go to disinfect.com because we have a whole infographic that we made before this came out.
Yeah, betul.
To show you that, you know, it basically says the same thing lah.
Yeah, betul. Okay. So, itu saja untuk minggu ini. Anda telah pun menonton dan mendengar Berita Busters. Saya adalah Zan Azli.
Dan saya Cheryl Busawan.
Dan anda boleh menonton episod-episod lain Berita Busters ini di semua platform fatbidin.com dan juga di website disinfect.com. Dan itu juga website yang kamu boleh dapat pelbagai infografik dan motion graphics tentang berita palsu mengenai COVID-19.
Dan rancangan ini dibawa oleh Rights Foundation.
Terima kasih.